نور النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام تيك الصحابة رضي الله تعالى عنهم أجمعين كوزو فور إكزامبل هاز سو ماني فرض يا فو فرض ويا فايف فرض ويا سكس فرض نبو وزو هاز سو ماني سنة وزو هاز سو ماني كونديشن صلاة هاز سو ماني كونديشن بيفور إت هاز سو ماني كونديشن إنسايد إت تيمم هاز سو ماني فرض These are the conditions for tayammum. These are the price for tayammum. None of these things existed at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in were very simple people and very good people. They were never asked Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam questions like this. Whatever they saw Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam doing, the manner they saw Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam doing that thing, it was the aim and objective of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in to follow Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam in that manner. Today, generally when we pose a question and we ask the ruling of a certain thing, today, astaghfirullah, the reason we do this, the majority of us is because we don't want to ask upon that thing. We ask, for example, the beard is generally a question that is posed. What is the ruling regarding the beard? When the answer is given, you should keep a beard. Because we don't want to keep it, then we say, okay, is this the opinion of all the imams? When this is so, okay, yes, this is the opinion of all the imams, then the next question is, we think it was the adat of Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam, it was a thing that was rife within the Arabs, it was a custom and a culture of the Arabs, and not a sunnah. So normally when we ask the ruling of regarding certain things, whether this thing is mustahab, whether this thing is mandub, whether this thing is wajib or fard, it is because we really don't want to ask upon these things. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in were great people. They never asked regarding these things because they didn't want to know. They wanted to see whatever Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam did and they wanted to follow 100% how Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam did because they believe لَكَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ The best of all examples in Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam. Finally, at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was no difference of opinion with regards to any issue of fiqh. With regards to any issue of jurisprudence at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like today we have a difference of opinion with regards to nearly everything. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was no difference of opinion with regards to any issue of fiqh. Because the thought was only one. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in would turn to Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam, and Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam would give him the answer. However, if there was some difference of opinion amongst the Sahaba due to different understandings of what Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam had said, the Sahaba would turn to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam yet again, and Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam would also solve the differences amongst the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. For example, the hadith Abu Dawud has recorded on the authority of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, two Sahabis were on a journey. It was time for Salah. They could not find any water. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in made tayammum and they offered their salah. Now before the time of that salah ended, they came across some water. Now one of the Sahabis did wudu and repeated the salah. Whilst the other Sahabi did not repeat the salah and nor did he do wudu. They came to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and they related the incident. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said to the Sahabi, who had not repeated his salah, he accepted sunnah. That you have acted within the limits of the shari'iyah. And to the sahabi that had repeated his wudu and repeated his salah, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said to him, لَكَ الْأَجْرُ مَرَّتَيْنِ You will be rewarded twice. So at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there was no difference of opinion with regards to any issue of fiqh. This takes us to fiqh at the time of the sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. As soon as Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam left this world, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in faced many problems. Problems which they had never faced at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. For example, the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. How should they give ghusl to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam? How should they give him kafan? Where and how should he be buried? Yet the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in witnessed the death of many people at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but the Sahaba had never witnessed the death of a prophet. This was a new problem to them. They faced many problems like this, that regarding the answers for which there was no necessary in the Quran and Sunnah. There was no clear verse or clear hadith stating that this is the solution of this problem. For example, after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was the problem of who should be the leader of the Muslims. This was a new problem. They had never faced it at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. At the same time, there was no clear verse which stated that this is the man that should become the leader of the Muslims after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nor was there a clear hadith which stated in clear words that this is the man that should become the leader of the Muslims. So this was a problem which they did not face at the time of Rasulullah, and it was a problem regarding the answers for which there was no necessary. It is because of this the Ansar said that they were more worthy of leadership than anybody else. Why? Because they were the ones who gave refuge to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. They were the ones who helped Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he required help. It was to them Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam migrated and made hijrah. And it is amongst them Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam lived and died. Thus the Ansar believed they were worthy of leadership than anybody else. Now the Muhajireen believed they were worthy of leadership more than anybody else. Why? Because they were the tribe of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala and the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam believed that they were worthy of leadership. Why? Because they were the Ahlul Bayt, they were the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After this problem was solved, there was, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu became Khalif, there was the problem of those Bedouins who were turned away from Islam and became Murtad. And there were people who refused to pay the zakat, which is one of the things that is compulsory in Islam. Now these people refused to pay zakat, but they believed in the kalima la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. And at the same time, they'd offer their salah. Now is it permissible for Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu to fight with these people? Yet Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, Umirtu an uqatil an-nas hatta yukulu la ilaha illallah, that I have been ordered to fight with the people till they say la ilaha illallah. And once they said la ilaha illallah, asamu minni dima'an wa anwalahum, they have saved their properties and their lives from me. Now it was a problem that the Muslims had not faced before. And no was there a verse of the Quran that said in clear words that yes, it is permissible to fight with these people, or no, it is not permissible to fight with these people. Nor was there hadith which stated, yes, it is permissible to fight with these people, or no, it is not permissible to fight with these people. Then there was a problem of whether the Quran should be compiled. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam left the world in such a state that the Quran was not compiled in the form of a book. Now should the Quran be compiled? It was a problem that they did not face at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Nor was there a verse of the Quran which said, yes, it should be compiled, or no, it should not be compiled. Nor was there a hadith which said, yes, the Quran should be compiled, or no, the Quran should not be compiled. Then there was the problem of the inheritance of a grandfather in the presence of brothers. Will the brothers also inherit with the grandfather, or will only the grandfather inherit? Yet again, there was no clear solution for this in the Quran and the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there were many, many problems like this, regarding the answers of which there was no necessary, there was no clear indication in the Quran and Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now as Muslims we believe that the Quran doesn't contain every single problem till the Day of Judgment in clear words, and the solution for every single problem till the Day of Judgment in clear words. For example, my sitting here on a chair with a mic in front of me, addressing you on a Sunday afternoon, this is not mentioned in the Sunnah of Rasulullah in the Hadith. And nor is it mentioned in the Quran. Nor is it mentioned in the Sunnah of Quran that this thing is permissible for Ahmad Ali to lecture you on a Sunday afternoon. Nor will you find this in the Quran. Now if every problem like this till the Day of Judgment was written in clear words in the Quran and Sunnah, then we would be in need of not one book or a few books. We would be in need of a billion books. Now as Muslims we believe that every principle that we require to solve any problem, that is mentioned, that is in the Quran and that is in the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when any problem arises which has been undefined by the Quran and Sunnah, we use these principles and we apply these principles to solve any problem which has been undefined in the Quran and Sunnah. And this is the belief of the Sunni Muslim. Now the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een were faced with all these new problems which they had not faced at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Problems regarding which there was no clear indication in the Quran and Sunnah that this is the solution to this problem. What did the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een do? They turned to make an ijtihad. Ijtihad is the reasoning process through which laws are deduced after thorough research. This is ijtihad. The reasoning process through which laws, Islamic laws are deduced after thorough research. So the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in turned to ijtihad. And it was from here, at the time of Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, we had the third and fourth source of Islamic, of legislation, of Islamic jurisprudence. The third